आरुरुक्षोर्मुनेर्योगम् कर्मम् कारणमुच्यते योगारूढस्य तस्यैव समः कारणमुच्यते। ओके, यू सिंग इट दिस वन। ओके, इट्स रिलेटिवली इजी एंड यू विल जस्ट फील बेटर इफ समथिंग कम्स आउट ऑफ योर माउथ ऑफिशियली। आरुरुक्षोर् मुनेर्योगम् कर्म कारणमुच्यते योगारूढस्य तस्यैव सम शम शमा शमा सेठ शमा शमा कारणमुच्यते। नाउ दिस इज अ इंटरेस्टिंग वर्स। फॉर द सेज सीकिंग टू स्केल द हाइट्स ऑफ योगा एक्शन इज सेट टू बी द मीन्स। For the same sage who has scaled the heights of yoga, serenity is said to be the means. What does it mean? It's a little confusing. Now, every action is led by, see, every action, there is a reaction. Okay? Every action has a goal. Okay? So, for people like us who are still on the path of yoga, who have not reached the height of yoga, what is the means of reaching the height of yoga? Action. Yes, you have to do, right? You have to do some action to reach the peace of yoga. But once you reach the height of yoga, once you reach the height of self-realization, what do? You don't do action? No. You still do action, but that time, the means of your action becomes quiescence, or what is it in serenity? It means I will write. So the stage of practitioner, sadhana, avastha. Okay, this is just Sanskrit. Avastha means state. State of practitioner means right now you are a practitioner. You're practicing, you're falling, getting up. What is the cause? Action. What is the effect? So right now, we as practitioners are doing all the action to generate peace of mind. Yes? Now, practicing, practicing, practicing. We reach the state of realization. So it's called Siddha. Siddha means the one who is realized. So what is the cause of his action? It's simple. simple. Once we see this, what's the, okay, I'm a realized person. What is the cause of my action? An effect of my peace. So, people like us who are on the path, we have to act to generate peace of mind. But a person who has realized himself through his peace of mind, actions will happen. Means what? Whatever. Jesus goes out on the street, people get healed by themselves. You look at a sage, just one look, and you feel peace of mind. There used to be a sage called Ramana Maharishi. He used to be silent. For 50 years of his life, he was quiet. He didn't speak anything, not much. And people used to go, big scholars used to go to see him with many questions in their head. The moment they would see him, mind would go blank. No questions. And when they would leave him, their questions would find answers themselves. Some of you here have been to his place. So, a person of realization, the peace of mind creates action. Will this peace of mind that creates action will have any selfish motive? No. I have written peace of mind here, but what Bhagavad Gita is saying is, and this is my favorite word in the whole of spirituality after devotion, contentment. If there is one variable that you should work upon at our stage of spiritual practice, is contentment. And many times I say this, contentment is the samadhi of active practical like us. Don't wait for samadhi. Every moment, try to generate contentment. And in contentment, you will find your samadhi, your union. And this is why the most important part of this triad is this. Cause. The whole word is cause and effect. But what is causing you to do what you do? And this is something that we need all of us to find out. Why do I do what I do? Cause. What is the cause? Why am I teaching yoga? And then the mind will say, I'm teaching yoga because I have to. No. Don't have to. I'm teaching yoga because I should. No. No should. I'm teaching yoga because everyone is teaching yoga. No. I'm teaching yoga because I'm a certified yoga teacher. Not really needed. So why am I teaching? Everyone, otherwise, if this is not clear, if your cause is not clear, effect will be varied. Effect will come, of course, Newton's law. But every class, you will get different feedback. One day you say, this is my purpose. You will come in and say, class is full. I was born for this. Now I know. Wednesday class, two people. You say, I should have kept my corporate job. I should not have quit my company. Only two. And Friday, full house. You say, universe is trying to tell me something. You know our old floral language as we spiritual speak. God sent me here for this. And then you are immediately the Messiah complex. You'll be fine. Don't worry.
I am there.
No. So cause. Cause. And for everything you need to ask. And this is contemplative life. This is reflective life. Remember, all of you have studied this in teacher training. Reflective life and not reactive life. This is reflective life. What is the cause? Because from here, do you see we are trying to fill the vacuum? Cause, trying to fill the vacuum. And stay away from should and must. Honestly, should and must will, it is nice if the should and must comes in your mind only when you have a very, very clearly defined purpose. If you don't have a clearly defined purpose, all the shoulds and all the musts are only the weight that you are putting on your own head. I should go out and change the world. I have so many good qualities. I must go out. And look, there are so many people suffering. I should. No. And I sound like a very evil man when I say this, but please try to understand why am I saying this. If it is should, if it is must, you will go and help somebody out of your selfishness. You will go to Syria, you will help the refugees, and you will say, they didn't even say thank you. Did you go to Syria to get a thank you? No. So how can you work socially? Work socially out of pure compassion. Pure compassion means what? Absolutely no need or no expectation of getting anything in return. Kill your ego in that. Do social service, but kill your ego. Suffer. You will suffer more than the refugees internally. Don't put a Facebook post. Go help the poor for 15 days without announcing. See how your ego dies a little death inside you. Go to Africa, work with poor people for 1 month. Work for 18 hours, help them. No Facebook post, no Instagram photo with a poor man. Nothing. Your heart will say, oh, I have to, no. And you see, kill your ego there. Do social service to kill your ego. Otherwise what will happen? You will go and then announce. Nothing happens. People you help will benefit. But what happened to your inner environment? Nothing. Zero. You encouraged your ego. We don't want social service like this. This is not karma yoga then. I just donated 1 million euros for this cause. And then the certificate and a picture. And there are people like this. There are people like this. There are so many people who work like those Doctors Without Borders and all. You know, these people were going here and there, places we will not even think of going to. They go, they do their job, they come back. I have a friend who works like, no one lives in work. Most dangerous places in the world. He does his whatever 1 month or something, never says anything and comes back to the city, works in a hospital as a doctor. No need. Pure compassion. I saved a life, I helped so many. Why? Again, if you want to do it, but there will be no growth. Is this clear? So the main point here is working out of contentment. So right now, what are we doing? We are in
We are in this stage. Huh? If some of you are in this stage, please take over. If we are in this stage, so we have to act, 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 act. So action should be done in which way? Two ways. Practical, spiritual. But in both the places, what should we remember? Detachment. We are still on the same point. That's it. Only when you do this, this will come out. If you don't work with detachment, what will happen? All your actions will be tuned towards fulfilling your ego. And here I don't even want to say anything, because here the mystics will make do actions that are not even in our, we can't understand how they do it.
Okay. So that verse was verse number 3. Arurukshor Muner Yogi. कर्म कारणमुच्यते योगारूढस्य तस्येव समः कारण क्षमः कारण उच्यते. वर्स नंबर 4. यदा हिनेन्द्रियार्थेषु, ओके सो लुक इन द बुक, यदा हिनेन्द्रियार्थेषु
नकर्मस्व
अनुषज्यते
अनुषज्यते
सर्वसंकल्प
सर्वसंकल्प
सन्यासी
सन्यासी
योगारूढस्य
योगारूढस्य
तदोच्यते
तदोच्यते.
So what is he saying? Verse number 4. When one does not get attached to the objects of senses or to the works and has renounced all purposes, then he is said to have attained yoga. So it's a conclusive verse of the first subject. So my commentary is, when a man is not attached to sense objects nor to actions, and who is free from all ego based plans, then he is said to have attained yoga. When a man is not attached to sense objects, nor to actions, and who is free from all ego-driven, need-based thoughts and actions, then he is supposed to have attained yoga. So this stanza, this verse is in continuation and basically concludes the first four verses. Look. A person can basically work out of two places. The first place is out of need, and a sense of egoistic importance. Egoistic importance, importance of ego. One can be active, you know, we will analyze, okay, activity. There are two ways of being active. One, active out of neediness or trying to please the ego. In such a case, selfish desires will be the root cause of action. This is continuation of what we wrote. In such a case, where you are basic, your intention is in neediness or in satisfaction of ego, your actions will be driven in ego. When I say ego, what do I mean? Limited self or limited mind, means conditioned mind. Now there is another level of working or acting. You can act out of fullness, not foolness, fullness and deep contentment. You can act out of fullness and deep contentment. In this kind of action, the beauty is you will have nothing to lose. When you act out of contentment, you will have nothing to lose. When you know you have nothing to lose, you will have more energy in your action. You are a billionaire and I come and tell you, can you give me 100 euros? You just give it like this. You have nothing to lose. Like they say, you know, that Bill Gates, he makes like $30 million every minute. So Bill Gates makes more money per minute than we would make in our lifetime. So you go to Bill Gates, I don't know if he will actually, but you go to Bill Gates and say, hey Bill, give me $1,000 bill. So we will just say, okay, take it. Because the guy who is earning $13 million a minute, for him thousands, like, okay, go. Pay your rent. Buy. He's not losing anything. But if you tell somebody who earns 1,000 euros a month, give me 1,000 euros, he'll have to think. I'm not saying he will not give, he'll have to think. So, oh, come after one month or 1 week. What does it mean? When you act out of contentment, you will have nothing to lose. So if you really want to act out of contentment, we need to generate contentment. Where is the contentment? Can contentment come from outside? No. But how many times we look at contentment from outside? So many times. Five senses. Eyes, ears, nose, mouth, skin, this is our major source of contentment. Major source of contentment. People who have to go for, people, you know, there are so many people who have to smoke in the morning to go to the toilet. Yeah, they can't go to the toilet if they don't smoke. They have problems when they travel, air travel, no? 13 hours flight, they are scared. Imagine they physiologically blocked, not just mentally, physiologically, that means what? Psychology has become physiology in their life. I can't go to the toilet if I can't smoke. So they'll go, and they don't have to smoke the whole cigarette also. They'll go, three puffs, come, now I feel good. You see what must be the state of that mind. This is sensory. Then emotional objective also. So senses will take you down, number one. Then the ego, selfish motives will take you down. I am a yoga teacher. I have to have at least one Lululemon pant. I am a yoga teacher. I should have a yoga teacher body, no? How will people trust me otherwise? I don't look like a yoga teacher. That means there's a structure of yoga teacher and all the yoga teachers should fit in that structure. Who made that structure? Some clothing brand made that structure. You know, we are smiling, we are laughing, but all of us know that these are real issues of a yoga teacher. I don't look like a yoga teacher. What is a look like a yoga teacher? Does Paramahansa Yogananda look like a yoga teacher? Does Iyengar himself look like a yoga teacher? Tell me which great yoga teachers of modern era look like the yoga teacher? Patabi Joyce look like a yoga teacher? What look are we talking about? These are real contemporary yoga issues. So the contentment is far, far away. When the teacher stands on the mat to teach a class, all these silly issues block their head. How will they teach the class? That is one. I don't look like a yoga teacher. Then I don't stretch like a yoga. I'm not bendy like a yoga teacher. Then I don't know Sanskrit like a yoga teacher. I have no lineage like a yoga teacher. Array, so many nowadays. I am only 200 hour, not 500 hour yoga teacher. Step back from all this. Okay. So, first four verses, conclusion. Number one, detachment is the real essence of yoga practice and a yogi. Number two, as a practical yogi, we have to act or work in practical world. Let us work and act in the practical world by keeping in mind two things. Let us work or act in the practical world by keeping in mind two things. Number one, not getting attached to temporary objects. And temporary object. Object doesn't mean any material object. It could be psychological object also. Please understand that. Not getting attached to temporary object. Objectives. And number two. With every action, trying to reduce the dominance of our limited mind. With every action, trying to reduce the dominance or the grip of our limited mind. Clear? This is the essence of the whole chapter. What we studied right now is the essence of the whole chapter. Not just the essence of the whole chapter, essence of Gita till the 6th chapter. So if you understand these 4 verses, you will understand Bhagavad Gita till chapter 6. Clear till here? Good. Now we'll take the next 2 verses, which are my favorite, one of my favorite verses in Bhagavad Gita. And it's just brilliant, and you can quote it anywhere. It's just brilliant. And the reason I like it, look, I personally am a big fan and supporter of self-work. Self-work means what? Self-reliance. It's my way. In what way? Reduction of dependence on external things. And in spirituality, mala, and then this, and then that, and I have to have my specific this, and I have to have my specific that, and specific this, and this only. In my life, I just have one mantra, and that's my only specific. Rest, you put me in swimming pool, you put me in the grass, you put me in a desert, I will do my spiritual practice. I don't need a mat, I don't need God photo, I don't need a mala, I don't need nothing. But this is my way, everybody has their own way. They carry their idols, they carry their mat, block. Reduce your, that's why the first word was anashrita. Have your support system. It's important. But how much support system? How much? So many supporting points that you don't even know which one is which. No. Have few that you can count on. Not plan A, plan B, plan C, plan D. Then you will never have enough faith in plan A. Have plan A and plan B. Enough. But if plan B fails, plan C. And what if plan C doesn't work? Plan D. And what if plan D doesn't work? Plan E. Then you will never put your whole heart and mind in plan A. It's logic. You don't need some spiritual wisdom in this. It's common sense. Don't spread yourself too thin on any surface area, practical or spiritual. And this is what I spoke in last weekend in the workshop as well. If you want to dig and find water, you have to dig in one spot deep. You cannot dig one place 1 foot, other place 2 feet, then 1 foot again, 1 foot. No. Take samples. If I want to find a well in this area, I will dig a little. But once I find the source of water, I will dig in the same place. Find your source and then start digging in the same place. And this is why the conclusion of last weekend's workshop in Vienna was, once you find your guru, your sadhana, don't look anywhere else. That's it. Then just dive deep. Till then, experiment. But once you find, at least if you have a little faith, then don't go to 10 places. You'll just be confused. Maybe that confusion will lead to clarity, who knows, but you know why. And that's why the next verses, they are just brilliant. One of, and you can see the brilliance of the composition of Bhagavad Gita. So what is the verse?
Uddharidatmanatmanam natmanam avasadhayet.
It's a little like a tongue twister, and it's a beautiful verse. I will tell you why it is linguistically beautiful. Okay, so let's say,
Uddhared,
Atmanatmanam,
Atmanatmanam,
आत्मनात्मानम
आत्मनात्मानम
आत्मा वर्ड इज यूज्ड ट्वाइस यू सी दैट नात्मानम अवसादयेत आत्मैव ह्यात्मनो बंधुर आत्मैव रिपुरात्मना लेट अ मैन लिफ्ट हिमसेल्फ बाय हिमसेल्फ लेट हिम नॉट डिग्रेड हिमसेल्फ फॉर द सेल्फ अलोन इज द फ्रेंड ऑफ द सेल्फ And the self alone is the enemy of the self. A beautiful verse in self-reliance. One should raise means what? Elevate oneself means what? Limited self by oneself alone means which? Higher self. Let a man lift himself. I am sure you all understand what is lift. Lift himself means liberate himself. By himself. You see why this verse is number 5. This verse is number 5 means first 4 verses he has told you that your release is not outside, it is inside. Not going to 10 gurus, not doing 100 courses, not wearing 20,000 malas. Your liberation is in your hands. So first 4 verses, he built up the scope. And now he's saying, look, what am I ultimately wanting to tell you is, you are your own savior. Let a man lift himself by himself. Let him not degrade himself. If you are your own rescuer, that means what? Opposite is also true. You are your own obstructor. There is a beautiful, one of my favorite verses, not in Bhagavad Gita, there is an Upanishad. It says, Mana evam manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayoho means, The mind itself is the reason for liberation and the reason for obstruction. That's it. That's the first verse of one Upanishad. Mind and mind alone is the reason for your liberation and the reason for your prison. Nothing else. Your hardware is good, end source is good, software is a problem. Hardware is good. Fantastic, see, hardware is good. End user, excellent, perfect. Self, soul. Problem is software, not upgraded. You're still from you have iPhone 6s, but inside you have iPhone 2 iOS. That's why it doesn't work, you know that? That's how they make money. New phone comes, even this Samsung KitKat and all these. You can't function a new device on old software. You have to upgrade. Your phone are upgrading at faster rate than you. Isn't it? We have changed 5 phones in last 10 years. We're still the same. It's on same software. Same virus. This is a beautiful verse. Lift yourself by yourself. Don't degrade yourself by yourself. Why? Because the self alone is the friend of the self and the self alone is the enemy of the self. Depending on how you use your mind, you will be your own enemy or you will be your own friend. You see the now you see why it is a song, it is a poem. It's not a prose, it's a poem. The word Atma has come 6 times in one verse. 6 times! And in different contexts. One time limited self, one time higher self. Remember this verse. You are your own savior. Don't wait for Christ to come back. He will come, he will not come. That is another topic. But Christ lives, Christ himself said, I live in your heart. So what are you waiting for now? Second coming for what? Such sages like Christ, like Krishna, live in our hearts through our faith and live in our minds through their words, through their teaching. Why are you waiting for a new upgraded version of Christ to come? The messiahs are there with us. Our guides are there with us in form of their message. But we want material. We are so object oriented that Christ gave his whole heart and teachings in form of Bible. But we want to see him. Physical. Bible? Gita? No. I want Krishna's idol. The teachings. They are their teachings. So practice the teaching and realize. The second part of this verse is also beautiful. And then we'll take both the verses together. For him who has conquered his lower self by the higher self, his self is a friend. For him who has not possessed or controlled his higher self, his very self will act in enmity like an enemy. Same context, huh? It's just, what does this mean? If you can use your higher self to liberate your lower self, your higher self is your friend. But if you don't use your higher self to liberate your lower self, your higher self is the enemy. Or your lower self is the enemy. Now look at this context from what we spoke yesterday. About who Krishna is. Who is Krishna? Some god sitting on the sky throwing electric currents down on us? No. Where is Krishna? Within us. Who are we? A part of Krishna or divinity. That means what? We have to remind ourselves again and again that we are divinity itself. We are divinity itself. Not someone else, but we. And that's the job of the guru. When you have a guru, you will look at guru as the divinity. But the job of the guru is to remind you that, hey, not me. You are also divinity. Not just me. And that's the job of the guru. He's a guide. Guru is a guide. A teacher is a guide. Now this is something very, very difficult for us to even digest. That I am divinity. Or I am made of the same material as divinity. Our struggle is being a yoga teacher. Forget being divinity. Our struggle is being 200 hour yoga teacher. Forget thinking of ourselves as divine itself. But this is a fact. The fact is, each one of us, not just humans, huh? There's nothing special about humans. Even the cat, even the small insect that you crush under your foot is of the same essence as you. And once you operate out of this vision, samadrishti is called, equal vision, you will never hate anybody. And this is why Christ and people like Christ can forgive, no? Lord, forgive them. Why forgive them? Because they don't know what they are doing. See, they are ignorant. You know what were Buddha's last words? Be a light unto yourself. Not, don't forget me. Please put your photo on, my photo on your wall. No. Buddha's last words. Be a light unto yourself. You know, when Buddha was about to die, one of his closest disciples, called Ananda, was crying. They were sitting. Buddha had told them, I am going to leave. So Ananda, one of his closest disciples, was crying. So Buddha asked him, why do you cry? So he said, you are leaving us, we will miss you. Now who is there to take care of us? You are our guide and blah, 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 blah. Just crying, crying, crying. Buddha looks at him and says, no, you are not crying because of that. You are crying because you have not really heard what I was saying to all of you for so many years. If you want to learn again what I was saying, look there. Manjushri is sitting under a tree. Talk to him. Manjushri was another from the inner circle of Buddha. But when all the disciples were crying around Buddha's body, Manjushri was sitting in the tree with deep contentment. So Ananda goes to Manjushri and says, Manjushri, why is it that we are all crying? And why is it that you are not crying? Why is it that you can sit with calm and contentment even when your own guru is dying like this? So Manjushri looks at Ananda and says, it's not that I don't feel sad that our master is leaving, but I am sticking to the fact that my master has helped me realize that I am my own light. And this deep faith in his teachings that I am my own light is making me be content and calm even when he himself, our light itself, is going to go off. I am still content because yes, he was our light, but we are our own lights as well. So this is a very, very beautiful story from the books of Buddha.